السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم، وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين، إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم صلي الله صلوات الله البر الرحيم والملائكة المقربين والنبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين على محمد بن عبد الله الصادق الأمين وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المطهرين وعلى أزواجه أمهات المؤمنين وعلى صحابته الغر الميامين وعلينا معهم أجمعين وعلى من اشتاق لزيارته والتشرف بالسلام عليه إلى يوم الدين إن شاء الله رب العالمين. We are continuing our journey with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, with the seerah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And last time we stopped at okay, so this is the barcode that can get you to the YouTube channel where you can find inshallah all the last episodes that we have covered till now. And we'll just go quickly because we have already started the third year of Hijrah and what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam started doing in the third year of Hijrah. So we'll finish all of this, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. And we came to, we spoke about how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Quran as a favor in different types of people, the Arabs, the Muslimin, the people of the book, the whole mankind and jinnkind, and even the angels. We also start by looking at how the Quran, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran praised the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a whole for his morals and even specifically. So he says, "When najmi idha," how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making this qasam or swearing by the star. "Ma dalla sahibukum wa ma ghawa." Ma dalla sahibukum wa ma ghawa. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is praising the mind and the mental capacities of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's not insane. He's not seeing things. He is the most perfect in the intellect. And then he praised how he has encountered the spiritual journey in al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. So he says, "Ma kadhaba al-fu'adu ma ra'a." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is praising the heart of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. "Ma zagha al-basaru wa mata." He's praising the sight of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he described the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Surah At-Tawbah, "Wasalli alayhim inna salataka sakanun lahum," that the prayer or the supplication of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is tranquility to the mu'mineen and the muslimin. And likewise, performing salah and salam on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will give us tranquility of the heart and peace of the heart and the mind. And the more we say salat wassalamu ala rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, especially in the day of Yawm al-Jum'ah, the more tranquility, the more peace, and the more light we have in our hearts and in our selves and our souls. I'll try to connect it again. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also in the Quran made this qasam, this swearing, this oath by the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he said, by your life. And he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, did not do this with anyone except Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he says in Surah Al-Hijr, "La'amruka innahum lafi sakratihim ya'mahun." So as he was telling the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the story of Qawm Lut, he then said, "La'amruka," which means by your life, ya Muhammad, they were in their intoxication, waiting for the punishment. And he made an oath for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he said, "Nun wal qalami wa ma yasturun." So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by the pen. And then he said, "Ma anta bi ni'mati rabbika bi majnun." You are not insane. In fact, you are on the highest level of morals. Then he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, referred to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a child. And he said, أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى. So he's referring to this part of the life of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم when he was a young child and an orphan. And a young man, وَجَدَكَ ضَالًا فَهَدَى, when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was searching for the true religion and going to غار حراء and trying to seek the true God of this universe. وَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is also referring to how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was not well off money wise, and then he made him rich by getting into the marriage from Sayyida Khadija, and rich by finding the true religion. Allah made the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his life and his existence a guarantee for people that they will not be punished. وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَأَنْتَ فِيهُمْ. Allah would never punish them as long as you are in them, among them. And then when the Prophet ﷺ passes away, مَا كَانَ اللَّهُ مُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَهُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. The other guarantee is that as long as they perform istighfar and return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not inflict them with punishment. Scholars say the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is still fihim, is still with us by his sunnah, by his guidance, and by performing salawat salam ala Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because in one of the hadith, ما من أحد يسلم علي إلا رد الله علي روحي فرددت عليه السلام. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has a special case in barzakh, in the partition between life and the afterlife. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is also making it particular for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in another hadith, تُعْرَضُ عَلَيَّ أَعْمَالُكُمْ. I see your deeds on Mondays. And whenever I see something good, I say alhamdulillah. And if I say otherwise, I perform istighfar for you. Scholars also say in Surah Al-Nisa, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْلَا أَنَّهُمْ إِذْ جَاءُوكَ ولولا أنهم إذ ظلموا أنفسهم جاءوك فاستغفروا الله واستغفر لهم الرسول لوجدوا الله توابا رحيما. That this ayah is in fact everlasting. So it is not just when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is alive, but if they come to the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and there they say salatu wasalamu alayka ya Rasulullah and ask Allah for forgiveness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive them there. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that أَمْ لَمْ يَعْرِفُوا رَسُولَهُمْ فَأُمْ لَهُمْ مُنْكِرُونَ. He is disapproving of the people who deny the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam while he lived with them a big part of his life. وَقَدْ لَبِثْتُ فِيكُمْ عُمُرًا مِنْ قَبْلِهِ. Okay, so last time we spoke about المد النبوي, which is the measure that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to, or the vessel that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to measure with it the zakat and sadaqat. And we have, alhamdulillah, a copy of Al-Mudd al-Nabawi. And this is a replica of the Prophet's mudd. In the hadith, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Allahumma barik lana fi muddina wa fi sa'ina. Ya Allah, make it blessed, our mudd. This is the mudd and the sa'. And he says, Allah, Allah fi ashabi. So don't insult, don't wrong my companions. فَلَوْ أَنْفَقَ أَحَدُوهُمْ مِثْلَ أُحَدٍ ذَهَبًا مَا بَلَغَ مُدَّ أَحَدِهِمْ وَلَا نَصِفًا. So if you spend like a mountain of gold, الصدقات, this will not be the size of the mud of one of the Sahaba, or even half of it. So I'll just pass this mud around to have a look at it and to see the barakah inshallah on it. And it comes with an ijaza. So in order to make sure that this has already been measured on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what it can give us inshallah around. If you are interested in getting one, they are sold on the internet. There is a Pakistani company that got the privilege of producing these inshallah. And otherwise I can give you inshallah the ijaza if you take the measurements and make one for yourself. Okay, so we spoke about the plots and the conspiracies and how Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf was killed and whether this was an assassination or not. And we stopped here, right? Stopped at the puzzle of the White Palace. What is the White Palace? And why do we get the picture of the Masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam here? Okay. Hello, have a good time. So I start by looking at this man. His name is Eddie Cohen, and this is his account on X Twitter. And he presents himself as an Israeli journalist who comes from the Jews of Lebanon, and he is also a researcher, journalist, PhD, and expert on Arab affairs. And he speaks Arabic and he writes in Arabic. Okay, so what did he write? And this was 2 days ago, or last week, 15th of September, 2024. He got a picture of Al-Masjid al-Nabawi, and then he wrote this. I'm translating what he's writing. Get back the Jews. Cross the borders. Go back to the lands of our forefathers. Return the glory of Solomon and David. Look at this white palace, the palace of the strong armor. On the two sides of this palace are the forts of Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf, Salam ibn Mashkam, and the square of Abi al-Haqiq, and the meeting place of Huyay ibn Akhtab, and the meeting place of Bani Sa'idah al-Khazrajiyya. Then he goes on and says, Wa marhaba. I lament the death of Marhab. He was the martyr of tears. And then he makes an oath that they will take revenge in Marhab ibn Abi Zainab by the number of sand and stones until their chests are cleared. When the Sufyani will come to the land of Karbala in the Kufa of Al-Khawarij. So it is a very heavy loaded tweet with many historical references. Many historical references. He's referring to the past and he's referring to the future. And he's using names of Jews from the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What's important for us is that he's mentioning Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf, and this is last week. He's still remembering Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf that we were speaking about. And some people would say, why should we spend time in the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to talk about a Jew who was killed because he was an enemy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? But they do not forget. They still remember him. And they write this tweet saying that we were revenged for the death of Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf and the others with him. And he gets this picture of Masjid al-Nabawi. And he said that this is al-Qasr al-Abyad. So, in fact, in saying Al-Qasr al-Abyad, the White Palace, this is a historical reference. In naming the fort of Ka'b al-Ashraf, this is a historical reference. And Huyay ibn Akhtab, and Abi al-Haqiq, and also Karbala, and looking at Marhab, who was killed in Khaybar, and Al-Khawarij. All of these are references to events in history. So, he said this, and he wrote this like last week. So first, why did he describe the Prophet's mosque as Al-Qasr al-Abyad? At the time of the Prophet, it was not like this. So this is like the new building of the mosque of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. At the time of the Prophet, it was not white. It was not a palace. It was just a small place made of primitive materials. But there is a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this hadith is so interesting and so shocking. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam one day made a khutbah among the people, and then he said, "Yawmul khalasi wa ma yawmul khalas," three times. The day of the ending, or the day of one of the days where Medina will be purified from its dirt. So it's the day of purification. Three times he said that. So they said, Ya Rasulullah, what is Yawm al-Khalas? What is this day? He said that Dajjal, the false Messiah, will come in the end of times. And he cannot enter Medina. He cannot enter Mecca. but he can be at the outskirts of Medina. So he ascends Jabal Uhud. He ascends the mountain of Uhud. And then he looks at Medina and he says to his companions, he says to his friends with him, أَلَا تَرَوْنَ إِلَى هَذَا الْقَصْرِ الْأَبْيَضِ. So Dajjal will describe the Prophet's mosque with this description. Don't you see this white palace? هذا مسجد أحمد. This is the mosque of Ahmed. And then he will come to Medina trying to enter it, and then he will find that on each street or each like tunnel that will get you into Medina, there are angels, and these angels are carrying their swords. And so they stop him and they prevent him from entering Medina. When he gets despair, he goes to Sabkhatil Jurf. Sabkhatil Jurf. There is an area outside of Medina known as Al-Jurf. And in this area, there is so rich soil, black soil, cultivatable, that is known as a Sabkha. So he puts his big tent. And then Medina will be shaken three times. After these like earthquakes, no hypocrite, man or woman, no wrongdoer who resides in Medina, except that they will get out to him and they will be with him from outside of him. So he cannot enter Medina, but the hypocrites will go out to him. فَتَخْلُصُ الْمَدِينَةِ. So this day is when Medina will be purified. And that's why this is the day of purification or the day of the ending. So this hadith is so interesting. First, it is about the end of days, about the time of Dajjal. Second, the Prophet ﷺ says that Medina and Mecca are protected from Dajjal, so he cannot enter them. But he can like move around. Then he looks at the masjid, at the mosque of the Prophet ﷺ, and he describes it as a white palace. At the time of the Prophet, when he said the hadith, it was not white and it was not a palace. But at our time now, if you look at it, yes, it is a big white palace, especially if you see it from the plane when you are descending to the airport going to Umrah, you can see it as a big white palace. Or if you ascend one of the mountains, as Masih al-Dajjal would be doing. And in order not to make you think of any other palace, it might be the palace of the king, but he says Masjid al-Ahmad. So he's referring to the Masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as al-Qasr al-Abyad. As I lived in Medina, one of my duties and my work was to go to different schools to supervise student teachers, the students who are training to be teachers. And one day I was asked to go to Al-Jurf. They sent me to a school at Al-Jurf. So I went to this area and I met the principal there. And I talked to him and I didn't want to tell him the exact hadith. I said, you know, this is Al-Jurf. So is there an area here called Sabkha? I said, yes, we are in the middle of Sabkha. And then I said, another hadith, it says, عند الكثيب الأحمر. So near to the Red Dune, small mountain. He said, وأين الكثيب الأحمر? Where is the كثيب الأحمر? He said, it is back to the school, that's back door. So they will not come here again. If you have all this, this is the place of the Masih al-Dajjal in your school. It will be their tent because all the description is there. But subhanAllah, I mean, common people know the place. Know that it's Jurf, know this is al-Jurf, al-Sabkha. And I have seen this small mountain like a dune. And it was red. And it is in front of the entrance of the school, subhanAllah. There. So Masih al-Dajjal, whom the Jews are waiting for, and they claim that this is their long-awaited king. And he is the king that will liberate the Jews, and he will rule the world, and they will be above all the world. So this man, this journalist, is making a reference to this hadith. And the hadith, by the way, صحيحٌ على شرطي مسلم ولم يخرجا. Like a note on the wording of the hadith scholars. When they say it is authentic hadith, sahih, it is authentic. When you say it is in Muslim and Bukhari. So Imam Muslim and Imam Bukhari have got recorded this in their books. But when we say ولم يخرجا, this means that Imam Muslim and Imam Bukhari have got some criteria for hadith to accept it or not. But at their time, they did not like have an exhaustive list of all the hadith. They did not be acquainted with all the hadith. So after their death and after they compiled their books, some scholars came like Al-Hakim, and they wrote books called Al-Mustadrak. Al-Mustadrak, these are the books that were revised the Sahih of Imam Muslim and Imam Al-Bukhari and add more hadith that fit the criteria. They fit the criteria that Imam Al-Bukhari and Imam Muslim have set out, but they have not seen the hadith. Had they seen the hadith, they would have included it in their own books. But because of the integrity, the scientific integrity, Imam Al-Hakim says that it is sahih, it is authentic, and it is following the criteria of Imam Muslim, but it has not been recorded because it was not during the lifetime of an Imam Muslim. That's why when we say walam yukharrija, this doesn't mean that it is invalid or that it is not authentic. It is authentic, and it is equal to all the hadith in the hadith of Sahih al-Imam Muslim, only he did not see it in his lifetime. So it was added to his book later on. So hadith sahih that describes the palace as the White Palace. So this journalist knows about this, and he gets the picture of the Masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he describes it as al-Qasr al-Abyad. But then he describes it again as Qasr al-Dir' al-Hasina. Inshallah, in the following weeks, we will get into details about Ghazwat Uhud. In Ghazwat Uhud, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, on the night of the Ghazwa and before going to meet the kafirin, he saw a dream. And in his dream, he saw that there were some cows that were slaughtered. He said, رَأَيْتُ كَأَنَّ بَقَرًا ذُبِحْ, as if some cows were slaughtered. And then he said, and I saw also in my dream that the tip of my sword was broken. ثُلْمَةً فِي سَيْفِ. And then he said, and I saw in my dream that I put my hand in a mighty and strong armor. So Sahaba radhiyallahu anhu didn't understand. So he said, مَا أَوَّلْتَهُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. What is the interpretation of this dream? He said, the cows that are slaughtered are martyrs from my companions. So some of you will be martyrs in this war, in this battle. And the tip that was broken in my sword, أصابوا في بعض أهل بيتي, some of my household will be killed. And this was Sayyidina Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib, Asadullah, رضي الله عنه. And then he said, and I put my hand in a strong, mighty armor. They said, how did you interpret this, Ya Rasulullah? He said, يرجعون الله إلى المدينة. So scholars said that one name of Medina is الدرع الحصينة, the strong armor, because this is how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam described it in his dream. And this man knows about this. And he says, قصر الدرع الحصينة. So very knowledgeable about the hadith, about the dreams in the seerah, about the interpretation of the dreams in the seerah. That's why I said a very heavy loaded tweet. If I need to explain this, I need like 15, 20 pages to explain the meanings here. But what is interesting, and it was shocking to me, that in the same week I was talking about Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf, he is also talking about Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf. And he is also saying that we were revenge to Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf for his death. And we explained why he was killed and that it was not an assassination. In fact, it was a killing for a traitor who violated and breached the constitution of Medina that the Muslimin like signed, the Muslimin, the Arab and the non-Muslims and the Jews and all people who were dwelling in Medina. And this is the link to the link to the tweet itself, like in his page. Yeah, so it is still there. And this is how he wrote it. And this is the picture of the Masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay, we will not like explain everything in the tweet, but it was important to mention Al-Qasr al-Abyad and Qasr al-Dara al-Hasina and also Ka'b ibn al-Ashr because we have come across him. The other ones, we will inshallah deal with them when time comes for them. But just to note that studying history and studying the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not a sophistication. Is not something that we try to entertain ourselves with. It is a basic need for the students and for the people of this ummah in this age. We need to know our religion. We need to know our seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We need to be acquainted with the references and the allusions that are used, because this is really the war of ideologies. And the more you know about your history, about your religion, about the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the more you will have deep faith in yourself and in the victory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay. One other thing that the Jews did in Medina, more conspiracies and more plots against the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned Ibn Abi al-Haqiq. Ibn Abi al-Haqiq is the one who came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, I will believe in you with one condition, that God, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends a letter to me. And in the letter, he says, Ya Abu al-Haqiq, believe that Muhammad is a prophet. So he has to mention my name and give it to me, should be addressed to me. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Subhana Rabbi, hal kuntu illa malakin rasula. Because he was asked this by the mushrikeen of Quraysh before. أو تنزل علينا كتابا من السماء. فأبى أكثر الناس إلا كفورا وقالوا لن نؤمن لك حتى تفجر لنا من الأرض ينبوعا أو تكون لك جنة من نخيل وعنب فتفجر الأنهار خلالها تفجيرا أو تسقط السماء كما زعمت علينا كسفا أو تأتي بالله والملائكة قبيلا أو يكون لك بيت من زخرف أو ترقى في السماء ولن نؤمن لرقيك حتى تنزل علينا كتابا نقرأه. So these are all the things they asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to do. And the response for this, full subhana rabbi, hal kuntu illa bashara rasula. I'm not claiming to be an angel or to have like supernatural powers. I'm just a prophet and a messenger who tells you what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks me to tell you. So they asked for a letter. They didn't ask like for a holy book to come to them because the Quran is already there. They asked for a written scroll. A written scroll that mentioned their names, that tells them Fulan and Fulan know that Muhammad is Rasulullah, and this is a way of mocking the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the message. And the Jews asked the same thing. Ibn Abi al-Haqiq is the one who came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, get from the sky a scroll that has got my name and it is addressed to me and to Huyay ibn Akhtab, asking us to believe in you. And Allah told them in سورة النساء يسألك أهل الكتاب أن تنزل عليهم كتابا من السماء. They ask you to bring down to them a book, and the word book in Arabic means also a letter, a scroll from heaven. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala soothes his prophet and say they had asked Moses even greater than this. They asked him, show us Allah outright in front of us. At the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied to every plot and dealt with every conspiracy. They were left with nothing but now plotting for killing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as we will see in Ghazwat Bani Nadir, and as in the seventh year of Hijrah, they will try to make sorcery to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay, in the same year, in the beginning of the third year of Hijrah, Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan married the second daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sayyida Umm Kulthum. Remember, we talked about Sayyida Fatima, Sayyidina Ali. We talked also about Sayyida Ruqayya and Sayyidina Uthman. We talked about Sayyida Zainab and her husband, Al-As. And here is the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Umm Kulthum. Some scholars say that Umm Kulthum was not her name. It was just a nickname. And her original name is Amina, and the name of her grandmother, the mother of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She was engaged to one of the sons of Abi Lahab, Utaybah ibn Abi Lahab. So Umm Kulthum and Ruqayyah, both of them were engaged to Utbah and Utaybah ibn Abi Lahab. The husband of Ruqayyah divorced her but didn't say anything bad about Islam, and later on he became a Muslim. But Utaybah ibn Abi Lahab divorced Sayyidah Umm Kulthum, and he insulted the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he tore the Quran. Jazakumullah khair, Sayyidi. And he tore the Quran and he came to spit on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam made a supplication to Allah that one of the dogs will eat him or kill him. So he went out in a caravan, Utaybah ibn Abi Lahab, with his father, Abu Lahab. And in the way to Sham, they missed their way. And it was night. So they had to spend the night in this area that they don't know about. And when they asked, they asked the people there, they said, this is Wadi Siba'. They said, the valley of the lions. So the lions are all around here. As Abu Lahab heard that this is the valley of the lions, he knew that now this will be the fulfillment of the supplication of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because a lion is a bigger dog. So he asked the people of Quraysh around him to protect Utaybah, and they got all of their stuff around him, and they made like a big shield around him so that if lions come at the night, they will not harm him. And the hadith, Rawi al-Hadith says, the narrator says that at night, the lion came sniffing around. And he will be sniffing around each one and then leave them, not harming them, until he reached out to Utaybah ibn Abi Lahab, and then he killed him. So he was to the particular da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She migrated to Medina, and she stayed with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for 2 years. And then when Sayyidah Ruqayyah died, Sayyidina Uthman married her. In fact, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the hadith said that Jibreel came to me and told me that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, marry Uthman, marry Umm Kulthum to Uthman. And when Umm Kulthum died in the 9th year of Hijrah, he said to Sayyidina Uthman, if we had 40 daughters, we would marry you one after one till they all are done, subhanAllah. And then he said, Zawiju Uthman, whoever of you can get Uthman to marry, get him to marry. okay. Yeah. SubhanAllah, one interesting thing happened also in Jamadi al-Thani in the 3rd year of Hijrah. Sayyidah Ruqayyah has passed away for like 4 months or 5 months now. And then Sayyida Hafsa bint Umar ibn al-Khattab had her husband died also. So Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab went to Uthman and he said, as you are now a widower and your wife died, Ruqayya, I'm presenting for you Hafsa. Would you like to marry Hafsa? Sayyidina Uthman didn't reply. And then Sayyidina Umar came to him again and asked him to marry Sayyida Hafsa. And Uthman was so like humble and modest and shy, so he didn't speak. For the third time he came and he asked him, but Uthman said, I don't wish to marry at this time. So Sayyidina Uthman, Umar became angry. And he went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, look at Uthman and what he says. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يتزوج عثمان خير خيرا من حفصة وتتزوج حفصة خيرا من عثمان. عثمان will marry someone who is better than حفصة, and حفصة will marry someone who is better than عثمان. So Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab was thinking, who is better than عثمان and who is better than حفصة? And subhanallah, عثمان then later on came to Sayyidina Umar and said, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to have any hard feelings, but I hear the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mention here. I hear that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions Hafsa. So I didn't want to say yes while the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam may have some desire for her. So out of respect to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I said that I don't want to marry. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then proposed to a Sayyida Hafsa and married her. and Sayyidina Uthman married Sayyidina Umm Kulthum. So Umm Kulthum bint Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is better in status, nobility than Sayyidina Hafsa. And Sayyidina Hafsa and Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, of course, he is better than Uthman. And then he says, ما زوجت عثمان أم كلثوم إلا بوحي من السماء. It was a revelation from Allah, from the sky, that أم كلثوم to be married to Sayyidina Uthman. She died in the ninth year of Hijra. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم prayed janazah and led the janazah prayer on her. And he buried her with himself. Sayyidina Ruqayyah, who died before him, was buried by her husband, Sayyidina Uthman. And the Prophet ﷺ did not attend her janazah because he was in Badr. And when he came, she was already in the grave. Sayyidina Asma' bint Umais and Safiya bint Abd al-Muttalib were the ones who did the ghusl for Sayyidina Umm Kulthum when she died. Okay. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also in the third year of Hijrah, and the beginnings of the third year of Hijrah, had to go to Ghazwat Buhran. It is also known as Ghazwat Al-Furu', Wadi Al-Furu'. And Al-Furu' is to the south of Medina, like 2 hours driving from Medina, Wadi Al-Furu'. And it is also known as Buhran because this is the area they're known. And people who were there were also people from Ghatafan and from Bani Sulaym. And we remember that Ghazwat Bani Sulaym went to the Bani Sulaym in their dwellings and they just fled into the mountains. And then they collected forces again and the Prophet ﷺ went to them in Ghazwat Bani Amr and they also fled to the mountains. And this time they were in Al-Furu', in Wadi Al-Furu' in Buhran. And then also they did not stay till the Prophet ﷺ came. And he stayed for there for 10 nights and no one came. So he got some of the camels and the sheep and the spoils and got back. Wadi al-Furu looks like this today. And it is on the way from Mecca to Medina. And the Prophet ﷺ prayed there on 2 areas. One area is in the valley and one area is on the top of the mountain. This is where one of the musalla of the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam prayed. It is called Wadi al-Masjid al-Akama in Wadi al-Furu'. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam slept there and prayed there. And he looked at Wadi al-Furu' and he prayed and made a supplication for barakah and blessings for the people of Wadi al-Furu'. And mashallah, it is a very nice scene, especially during the springtime when rain comes and then there will be creeks and like small rivers of water that come from on the tops of the mountain, like in water torrents, and it will turn the whole place into a Jannah and an oasis. Okay, so this is Wadi al-Akama, and this is what Sayyidina al-Imam al-Samhudi mentions about this in Wadi al-Akama, in Masjid al-Akama. Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhuma, he used to go and seek the places where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam performed salah, and he would perform salah in the exact place at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam performed salah. But out of respect to the Prophet ﷺ, he would not stand where the Prophet stood. He would stand a little bit behind, so that when he makes sujood, his head would touch the place of the feet of the Prophet ﷺ. So rather than standing on the place of the Prophet and putting his head where the Prophet's head was, he puts his head where the feet of the Prophet ﷺ was. And he knew that the Prophet ﷺ also slept, took a nap in this place, in Masjid al-Akama. So he slept next to it. So you see the respect of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And Salim Mawla Abdullah ibn Umar was also doing the same. So they were following this sunnah of tracing the places of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and being so close to it and seeking baraka from them. جزاكم الله خير. الإمام الطبري in تفسير when he was talking about ثانية اثنين إذ هما في الغار, he mentioned that الإمام السهيلي, الإمام السهيلي was a big imam and scholar from Al-Andalus, said that he went specially when he went to Umrah and Hajj in Mecca, he went specially to غار ثور. And he entered غار ثور and he started explaining the meaning of the ayah ثانية اثنين إذ هما في الغار while he is in الغار. While he was in the cave. And he explained the meaning and then he spent 3 nights because the Prophet ﷺ spent 3 nights there. And he said, I was seeking the barakah, I was seeking the blessings that this place had, the breath of the Prophet ﷺ in this place. And this was the act of the scholars long ages. Today, if you are in Medina, this is Medina, and this is where the mosque of the Prophet ﷺ in Wadi al-Fura is, and this is the road. It is a good road. I mean, no problem in reaching it for 2 hours driving, and you will find even like a big notice here telling you that this is Wadi al-Fura when you are close to it. Okay, we have also in this year Sariyat al-Qarada. سرية القردة. So we'll talk about سرية القردة, سيدة أم المؤمنين حفصة, سيدة أم المؤمنين زينب بنت خزيمة. If we have time, we'll speak about سيدنا الحسن بن علي because he was born at this year. And then we'll speak also about how الخمر was prohibited. And finally, this will get us to Ghazwat Uhud, which will be a big new episode, inshallah. So we'll try to cover as much as we can today, inshallah, and next week we will continue. So we say that Ghazwat Al-Qarada. Now, you remember that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to Badr in order to block the road for the mushrikeen, to block their freight caravans from going to from Mecca to Sham. To the Levant. He tried it many times before Badr, but each time they would surpass, he would miss them. And even in Badr, he missed them, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him better than this, which is the victory in Badr. So Abu Sufyan realized now that the Muslimin are now the victorious, they will not let him safe, let him go back safely. I mean, in his way to Sham, in the second year of Hijrah, they tried to block his road, block his route in Ghazwat al-Ushayra. And when he was coming back from Sham to Mecca, they blocked his route in Badr. So it is not safe to go back to the Levant on the way near to Medina. They need now to find an alternative route. They need to find an alternative route that does not pass by Medina. So they went to an expert with the routes in the desert. And he told them that there is a route that will take you from Mecca to near Iraq. And then you go to Sham, to the Levant. And this will be far away from Medina. So it is a longer route, more dangerous route, but it is safer from the Muslimin to block the road. So you can see here, this is in Medina, and here is near Mecca, Taif and Mecca. So the best way for them to go is just to move near to the coast of the sea till they reach Palestine and Gaza. But this time they have to go this way, all this way, and then from here to go to Najd, and then go to Dawmat. Al-Jandal to Mu'ta in Jordan and then go to Palestine. So it is double the distance. And the Prophet ﷺ knew about this. And he decided not to let them go feeling safe for what they have done, especially after they have already come to Medina and made some trouble in Ghazwat al-Sawiq. Remember, Abu Sufyan came to the Jews and he asked them and they gave him the secrets of Medina and he tried to do anything because he was having this kind of swearing that he would never have ghusl or wash his body until he goes to Medina and do anything. So he went to Medina, and in the army they had with them the dry dhow that has got the pies, sawiq. And they killed three men and took a number of camels. When the Prophet ﷺ knew about this, he tried to follow them and to chase them, but they were now closer to Mecca. So he found the camels are left and the pies are also left. So he got these back, but he did not revenge for the two men that were killed. So when he knew that the mushrikeen in Mecca are now trying to find an alternative route to Damascus and to Palestine, and he knew that it would be near to Al-Qarada, and Al-Qarada is the name of the well. There is Ghazwat the Qarad, and there is Ghazwat Al-Qarada. These are the names of the wells of water, because we knew that the caravans would not just take the shortest route, they will take the route that has got water, so that each water would be a station for them to rest and for their camels to drink. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent Sayyidina Zayd ibn Haritha, his adopted son. And he asked Sayyidina Zayd ibn Haritha to go and to block the route for the mushrikeen and see what they are doing. So it is said that Safwan ibn Umayyah was trying to get his caravan to Asham, but Abu Sufyan told him that if you go near to Medina, you would lose all your money, you would lose all your caravan. So he said, but we are people of trade. We don't know how to farm or cultivate. We need to trade. So if we stay and don't move on, then our capital, the capital money, will be also wasted. So we have to do something. So Furat ibn Hayyan al-Ajli, this man was an expert in the routes in the middle of Arabia, in Najd. So Safwan got all the people and got all their monies, and then he tried to move away from the Muslims' authorities and the control areas of the Muslimin. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent Zayd ibn Haritha in 100 fighters, and they went to Al-Qarada, and the books tell us that they met the caravan and they stopped the caravan, and they took all the money on the stuff and the merchandise that they had, and the men in this caravan, they fled away. And only the ones that were taken as prisoners of war were the guide, Hayyan al-Ajli himself, and some others. And on the way, when he was asked to accept Islam, he accepted Islam. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam set him free. We don't have like lots of details about what happened in this Syria, but it is interesting that this is the first time that the Muslimin block the route and find the caravan. I mean, they tried it in Ghazwat al-Ushayra and they missed it, and they tried it in Ghazwat Badr and they missed it, and they tried it in different other ways. In fact, Saif al-Bahr, which was on the coast of the sea, they saw the caravan in front of them, but at this time they were few in number, only 40 people with Sayyidina Hamza ibn Abd al-Muttalib. And there were many of the mushrikeen armored. So Majdi al-Damri min Bani Amr ibn Bani Damra decided to just get the two forces away. So he got his people and they passed between the two forces until each one got away from each other. So this time the Muslimin were ready and they went to Al-Qarada, and it seems that they arrived there before the caravan arrives. And so they made all their precautions and their own procedures so that they will be ready when they come. And so they captivated some of them and they took every one of them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran says, وَضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا قَرْيَةً كَانَتْ آمِنَةً مُطْمَئِنَّةً يَأْتِيهَا رِزْقُهَا رَغَدًا مِنْ كُلِّ مَكَانٍ فَكَفَرَتْ بِأَنْعُمِ اللَّهِ فَأَذَاقَهَا اللَّهُ لِبَاسَ الْجُوعِ وَالْخَوْفِ بِمَا كَانُوا يصنعون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the example of a city or a village that was blessed within the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where every rizq comes for it from different places, from different directions. And Allah sent them his blessing, and the blessing of the Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, but they denied these blessings. So what happened? فأصابها الجوع والخوف. So they were struck by hunger and fear and terror. Hunger, we will come to this inshallah after Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, but fear is his now. Scholars say the fear happens when the Prophet ﷺ was sending his armies, saraya, in different places, in different areas, to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south. And the mushrikeen of Quraysh do not know where to go. And in fact, this was another cause why they wanted to have Ghazwat Uhud. They wanted to get back a victory so that they can sustain a way for their merchandise to be in the caravans to the Levant. It was something economical in addition to the pride that they lost in Ghazwat Badr. And this is Sayyidina Zayd ibn Haritha, the adopted son of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who led this Sariya. سيدة حفصة أم المؤمنين سيدة حفصة بنت عمر بن الخطاب. Her first husband, his name was خنيس بن حذافة السهمي. خنيس بن حذافة السهمي was a صحابي, and he also migrated to Medina with his wife سيدة حفصة بنت عمر. حفصة is the female name from حفص, and حفص is a name given to the line. So someone who is strong, someone who is dependable, someone who is admirable in their might and their resilience. And Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab was called for her. His nickname, kunya, was not Abu Abdullah or Abu Ali. It was Abu Hafs. So even her name was mentioned with her father all the time, Abu Hafs. And the Tamarbut has dropped for truncation, which means that she is like so beloved to him. Sayyida Hafsa bint Umar, her husband participated in Ghazwat Badr, and he died there. He became a martyr, or some scholars say he was not a martyr in the Ghazwa, but he died after the Ghazwa when he returned to Medina. And so Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam proposed to her. And she was also one of his wives. And remember, at this time, the Prophet ﷺ had only two wives, Sayyida Aisha and Sayyida Zainab bintu Sauda, Sayyida Sauda. So these were only the two wives at the third year of Hijrah. Then Rasulullah ﷺ married a Sayyida Hafsa in Sha'ban, and married a Sayyida Zainab bintu Khuzaima in Ramadan. So 2 months after each other. Sayyida Hafsa bint Umar ibn al-Khattab is so important also in one hadith that she like made the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam angry. And in fact, it was like all the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made him angry at one day. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed Surah Al-Tahrim in this, لِمَ تُحَرِّمْ مَا يَا أَيُّهَا رَسُولُ لِمَ تُحَرِّمْ وَمَا أَحَلَّ اللَّهُ لَكَ تَبْتَغِي مَرْضَاتَ أَزْوَاجِكَ. So it was known to Sayyidina Umar, it came to Sayyidina Umar that the Prophet ﷺ divorced his wives, especially Hafsa. And he was so distressed, and he started to get sand on his head and say, my daughter now lost the dunya and the akhirah because the Prophet ﷺ divorced her. When he went to the Prophet ﷺ to ask about that, he said, I divorced her one divorce, but Jibreel came to me and said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, get her back. Take her back because she is doing lots of fasting and lots of night prayer. Sawama qawama. She does maintain and observe lots of fasting and lots of qiyamul layl. And because of this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to return her back. Sayyida Hafsa bint Umar is also known for her amana. And in fact, she played a big role in getting the Mus'haf to us. This Quran that we read in, Sayyida Hafsa played a very important role in preserving the Mus'haf and getting it to us till today. And this happened because when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab thought that with the apostates and the people who left Islam and people who are coming to Medina and planning to invade Medina, a lot of the Huffaz, a lot of people who memorized the Quran were killed. So he was afraid that by one time we will not find anyone who memorized the whole Quran. So we need to get the Quran in one book. So he went to Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and asked him to collect the Quran in one book and should be authentic book for all the Muslimin to follow. Sayyidina Abu Bakr at the beginning said, but this is not something that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. He said, yes, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't do this because the revelation was continuous during his lifetime. And it was not in order. So it was not this surah, then this surah, then this surah. It was like different ayat. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned to his prophet where to put this ayah and where to put this ayah. For example, the Mus'haf starts with Surah Al-Fatiha. But we all know that the first verse that was revealed was Iqra. And Iqra is near to the end of the Mus'haf. So the arrangement of the book is not like the arrangement of the revelation. So how did Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq respond to this? And how Sayyidina Umar followed on this? And how Sayyidina Hafsa played a role in preserving it for us? This we'll know, inshallah, next time. جزاكم الله خير تقبل الله منا ومنكم وغفر الله لنا ولكم صلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.
وقت قبل الإقامة في ربط